Oh, come all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh, come ye, oh, come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. Oh, of angels singing exaltation. Oh, sing all ye citizens of heaven above. Glory to God, oh, glory in the highest. Oh, come, let us adore.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Discovery Church. That was a Christmas song because it's Christmas time. Let's do some worship songs. We're going to just sing together, sing out to God. Let's pray, and then we'll jump on in. God, we just thank you for this place. Thank you for giving us this opportunity where we can come and just as a community sing out these words to you, God. Wrestle with these ideas, wrestle with these concepts, and just be with each other and be in your presence, God. In your name we pray. Amen.
Love is deep, love is wide, and it covers us. Love is fierce, love is strong, and it's furious. Love is sweet, love is wild, and it's waking hearts to life. Love is deep, love is wide, and it covers us. Love is fierce, love is strong, and it's furious. His love is sweet, his love is wild, and it's waking hearts to life. Sing out his love. His love is deep, his love is wide, and it covers us. His love is fierce, his love is strong, and it's furious. His love is sweet, his love is wild, and it's waking hearts to life. Can tear us from
Open up your heart, let me in.
That song for some of us can feel a little out of the ordinary, a little unusual. We're so used to coming into an environment like this and singing songs to God, singing songs about God. And then this song takes this weird turn where it's from the perspective of God. It's what God is saying to us. It's declaring that God wants to take us on this amazing, immeasurable journey with Him, and it's Him speaking to us. And for some of us, it makes us a little bit uncomfortable because it's out of the ordinary. And when we look at our prayer lives, sometimes we can realize that there's so much from us going to God. There's so much of, this is what I desire, this is what I want, this is what I need, that we don't take the time to slow down and see what it is that God is saying to us. We don't take time to be still and be silent, to let language fade away and just listen to what it is that God has to say to each of us. We're going to take communion here together. And this is how we choose to remember the sacrifice that Jesus made, how we choose to to honor the fact that we were dead, we were in darkness, we were lost, and that our God loved us enough to pull us out, to reach a hand down and pull us up out of darkness and out of the grave. And as we take this communion together, let this be an opportunity to be still, to be silent, to be quiet before God, and just to listen to what it is he is saying to you, to listen to what it is he has for you in this moment. If you're not familiar with how this works, what's going to happen is some trays are going to come up and down the aisle with a little wafer and a little cup of juice. Take one of each of those, take it on your own time. I'm not going to come back up and do it all together. And if you haven't been here over the last few weeks, this weird phenomenon has started where people are now shattering the cups in their hand as a symbol of the breaking of the bondage of sin, the breaking of the bondage of evil, of the old covenant, and declaring it is finished. So when these cups start popping all around you, don't freak out. And if this is all weird to you and you don't want anything to do with it, it's fine. Just pass around to the next person. No one's going to ask you to leave, judge you, anything like that. We understand that completely. So let's pray, and then we'll take that together. God, we thank you that you loved us enough to make a sacrifice to pull us out of the grave and to redeem us, God. And we thank you for these subtle reminders just to sit and be still and just abide in your love and just listen for your voice. Listen for the hum that we know flows through everything, God. As we take these elements this morning, we thank you for the sacrifice that you made. And God, we thank you that you grab our hand and want to take us on this amazing adventure that is our lives, God. In your name we pray. Amen.
I'm Derek Schaefer. Life before Jesus was very confusing. It was a hard place. I had a lot of anger issues, very down on myself. I've always felt there was something bigger in life to work for, and I was thinking that it was a job or, you know, a girlfriend or something like that. Was not really interested in the church. You know, I kind of naysayed it a little bit. I read the book, Case for the Creator. My friend gave me the book about 3 years ago, three and a half, and I just put it on the bottom of my book stack, and I said, I'll get to it when I, you know, finish the other books, and came up about a year and a half ago, and I read it in about 2.5 weeks. You know, being a science-minded person, to him to go try to disprove religion and become a believer himself, and then how far he's come as a believer, it was just, you know, it spoke to me. It really was like kind of the driving reason why I came to DCC. And the very next day, I met Kristen, you know, and she was like, hey, I go to this awesome church. If you really want to go check it out, you know, we can go together on Sunday. And we went to first service that week. I cried. It was crazy. I didn't think I needed as much as I thought I did. And I've been back every single weekend from then. I look forward to Sundays now. I don't, I used to hate it. I used to hate going to work on Sundays. I used to say Sundays are just for rest and football. Now we go to first service because it starts our day off right. It just makes me really happy to be in a place that I know that it's a positive situation every time I'm in here. And I sit in the rows, and I feel like Greg's talking to me every single weekend. I finished Wild at Heart, and then the last couple of series have been really going along with how the Wild at Heart ended, you know. And that was the most powerful part of that book, was the ending. And it's not something that you just do once a week. It's a thing you wake up in the morning and, you know, you put God's armor on and you go to work, and, you know, and know that he's right there on the side of you. I'm not going to win every single battle, you know, but throughout the war, I know I have the best support cast in the business. I know that he's working in my life every single day. The anger I had is now leaving me because of everything that's been going on in my life and affecting Jesus. I definitely want to thank Don Brown and my men's group. Those guys are awesome. I know that I am part of a band of brothers that I know I will never forget. If I need help, I got guys I can rely on. But definitely thank Kristen for showing me DCC. Without this place, without her, I don't know where I'd be. I'm getting baptized as a justification to overcoming the fact that I was doing wrong things, and now I'm on the right path. And I dove right in, you know, I dove in really to the deep end and just went and gave up my life to Jesus.
Derek, the first time you came to church here, you said that God told you it was about time. I'm excited to see how God is going to continue using you on your journey. I want to thank Greg for taking the time to get to know you. I want to thank Don Brown and the men in your Wild at Heart group, because those men will never fully understand the impact they have had on your life. Lastly, I want to thank DCC, because from the moment you walked in the front door, you felt welcome, there was no judgment, and you felt safe. Derek, you have truly been rescued, and it is with great pleasure that I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
That's awesome. We had another baptism first service. You guys want to go back and watch that on the stream? It was also really, really wonderful. So first service also, I wished everybody a happy first Sunday of Advent. And then all of you nerds texted me and told me that it is the second Sunday of Advent. Happy second Sunday of Advent. This is the last we're going to hear of Advent. But we thought we would celebrate it with an ancient and beautiful poem by the patron saint of pop music, Miss Mariah Carey.
I want a lot for Christmas. There's just one thing that I need. I don't care about the presents underneath the Christmas tree. I just want you for my own.
So that very well may be the most depressing Christmas video I've ever seen. How about you, right? You're like, whoa, please don't play that again, right? Hey, more about that in just a minute. Before we go there, though, good morning and welcome to DCC. Good morning to you. Hey, there you go. We're so glad to have you with us here today, especially if you're new. If you're new, hey, here's what we want for you. We want you to be able to walk away from here today. Here's what we hope you feel and experience and walk away with today. That you walk away and you say, you know what? I was just in a room full of people who are just like me. That all of my story was safe and welcome there, and that I belong there with them regardless of the fact that I didn't even believe what I think that they believe. Because that's true in this place every single week. We hope you feel that and you experience that in your time here with us today. So thanks for being here if you're new, and a special shout out and thanks to all of our friends who can't be here but are watching us live online right now too. Good to have you with us. So we're in a series called Hopeless, and we're trying to answer kind of those questions that are in that very happy video that we just showed. More about that in just a minute. Before we get to that, though, I want to talk about that song for just a second that Carla just sang. How about that song? Which, did they do good? It was awesome, right? Let's talk about All I Want for Christmas Is You. Now, I don't really know who Mariah Carey's talking about these days. It used to be Nick Cannon. It's not even, I don't know who you is. Who is you? I don't know who you is for Mariah this year, but it doesn't really matter. It's not important. Here's what's important. How would you or I fill in that blank? How would we finish that sentence? All I want for Christmas is blank. I think it's pretty interesting how that answer changes throughout the years, throughout the course of our lives. I told you before, I love Christmas music. I'm just a Christmas music fanatic. It started when I was a little kid. When I was a kid growing up, when the Christmas decorations came out, the Christmas music would come out too. Anybody else live in a house like that? There's a few hands. Good. Somebody said no in the first service. I'm like, well, you're weird. But So the records, okay, back in my day, I know this is a long time ago, we had records. They were these round things. They're like this. They were called 45s. And we had a stack of Christmas 45s that would come out. So when the Christmas decorations would come out, the records would come out too. My two favorites, I'd always go right to my two favorites. The first was Little Christmas Stocking with a Hole in the Toe. It's a classic. If you haven't heard it, get your Kleenex. It will make you cry. All right, that's my favorite. Actually, it doesn't. I had our staff listen to it a couple years ago, and they didn't cry. Something's wrong with them, right? That's my favorite. Second favorite was All I Want for Christmas Is, not you, it's my two front teeth. Anybody else like that song? It's a classic song, right? And I think there's some truth to that. I really do think there's some truth to that when you're young and you don't have your teeth yet and you're kind of ugly because of that and you don't want your teeth. So there's that period of time in your life. But then you grow up and you want toys and then it becomes electronics and then iPads or Xboxes or MacBooks or iPhones. And then you hit those hormone-raging teenage years and Mariah's right, All I Want for Christmas Is You, right? Or if you're a teenage boy, it's you and you and you and you and you and you. Yeah, it's like that. That's kind of how it goes when you're a teenage boy. But then you sort of outgrow that, sort of, and you become a grown up. And then your list changes, and really it becomes less about you for most of us. It becomes less about you. And so there's a song, Grown Up Christmas List by Amy Grant. I love that song too. It makes me cry. You know, and it becomes that, right? No more lives torn apart. Wars would never start. Time would heal our hearts. Everyone would have a friend. And right would always win. Love would never end, right? That's our grown up Christmas list. So there's a season in life where that's kind of the list too. And then you look up one day and life has come around full circle and you find yourself in diapers again wishing you had your teeth, right? It's just true. You depressed yet? Are you depressed yet? Merry Christmas. All right, so, hey, all of that to say, regardless of what word or words you think you would choose to fill in that blank, I don't think the words that you've picked are really the words that you would fill that blank in with. I don't think that ultimately reflects what's really going on deep inside. So why is that? Why is it that the words we choose are not the words that really sit deepest within our hearts? I'm going to tell you why I think that is, okay? I think it's because we have this thought, what difference does it make? Does it really matter? So the thing I really want most is for my marriage to make it, for my relationship with my kids to be restored, to not have this addiction, to not be struggling with cancer or infertility, that joblessness, my finances, my health, but the days and the weeks and the months and even the years that have passed by, you just get to the point where it just feels what? Absolutely and completely hopeless. And you get to this point where you're like, what's the use? There's no sense in even talking about that. It is what it is. It's absolutely and completely hopeless. And if you feel like that, I get that. Me too. I think we all do. We all do. What can we do with that? What can we do with that? That's why we're doing this series. We're trying to answer that question. There is something that we can do, and we can find hope in that. So what do we do? How do we do that? What do we do when we hit the wall? What do we do when the circumstances of our lives suggest to us that there's no way forward and no way out? There's just all kinds of problems in our lives without solutions. There's all kinds of questions, and we have no real answers. What do we do when there's nothing, absolutely nothing we can do to change the circumstances of our life? That's really the question. Is there any hope in with that stuff? And the answer we said last week is yes, but we need to start by embracing the fact that sometimes God's actions or inactions are going to seem inconsistent with a loving God. It's just true. We've got to embrace that. And we got to understand that we tend to trust God to the extent he does what we want and expect him to do in our lives. And it's those wants and those expectations, when they're unmet, that cause a lot of us to question whether or not we can even believe in God, and cause the rest of us who do to lose hope and to lose heart too. So we got to talk about this stuff. Let's go back to where we started this thing last week. When there are no real solutions, there's still options. When there are no real solutions, we can still have and find hope. So how and where do we do that? Those are great questions. Let's dive back into this together today, continue the conversation, and let's just see. All right? That's where we're going to go today. So 2 Corinthians chapter 12. 2 Corinthians chapter 12 is where we're going to be today. If you have a Bible, you want to turn there, go ahead and do that. If you don't have a Bible, hey, we've got them on the back tables back there. If you want to take one, steal one, whatever you want to call it, it's yours to keep. If you can't get there now, get it on your way home. Take it home. Take it home as a gift to a friend. Yes, you can take an extra one if you want to do that. Hit our app, hit our website, or the YouVersion app. Probably shouldn't hit our website. Or you can watch the live stream, which is probably better than me live. So, you can do that. You can read off the program, or you can read off the screens to my left and my right here as we go. So 2 Corinthians chapter 12, beginning with verse 6. Even if I should choose to boast, I would not be a fool, because I would be speaking the truth. But I refrain, so no one will think more of me than is warranted by what I do or say, or because of these surpassingly great revelations. Therefore, in order to keep me from becoming conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. Three times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me. All right, let's stop right there for just a second. So, a guy named Paul's writing this. He's a guy, by his own admission, who has every right to be conceited. We're not giving all the details here, but he's got every right to be conceited, including but not limited to a round trip to heaven that he has just received. So you got to go on, you got to read the verses leading into this. So read all chapter 12 this week, and you'll see this. God took him like a vacation to heaven and back. That's awesome. Not many people get that trip. And so he's got every reason to be conceited, he says, including that. And in order to help with this conceit, he's given a thorn in the flesh, and he asked God to take that away. Okay, which makes sense to us, right? So he's got this point of pain, this problem in his life. But before we talk about that, the problem, I want to talk about this guy a little bit more who has the problem, because I think it's important for us to see this. Before his name was Paul, his name was Saul. He was a very, very religious guy, and he made a living persecuting and killing Christians or followers of Jesus. He believed in God. He didn't believe Jesus was the Son of God. So he made this living killing and persecuting Christians. So if you have things in your life and stories, you sit here today, that you wish you could erase, change, delete, do over, I would say to you, me too. I've got plenty of those. And Paul would say, me too. So what I want you to understand is, Paul, when he used to be Saul, he was initially anti-Jesus. He was anti-Jesus until something very, very significant happened in his life. And I love the way that Andy Stanley describes the lead-in up into that moment. If you don't know the story of Paul hits the scene after Jesus is crucified, he's buried, he's resurrected from the dead, he ascends up into heaven, and this thing that we're doing today, you're sitting in today, called church, really gets started. And when the church got started, it had all this momentum. I'm like 3,000 people one day, and people were like, I'm in. And it was growing like crazy until Christians, Jesus followers like you and me, started to be persecuted for their faith by guys like Saul. And then all of a sudden, the church stopped growing. The church just stopped growing. And God calls Jesus over and he says, son, come here, I got to show you this. You see this? He says, your movement, this revolution that you started, it's not growing anymore. And I think you may have chosen the wrong guys to lead it. With all due respect to Peter and James and John and those guys, I think we need a new leader. We need a new leader who will be bold, who will be courageous, who's willing to get on a boat and travel around the world and spread the word, right? Who's relentless, who's fearless, who's intimidating, who's focused, who can build a movement of people and gather momentum. That's what we need. And just for fun, I think we ought to pick a Pharisee. And I tell you what, tell them if they do a good job, they can write half the New Testament. Right? Oh, how about that guy right there, Saul? And Jesus is like, whoa, dad, hold on, time out. Do you realize he's trying to undo everything I came to earth to do? Do you realize that? And God's like, exactly. That's the kind of guy we need. Right? Now, so that's kind of the background for the story. And so Jesus appears to Saul on the road to Damascus. He becomes Paul, and his story changes. So that's a little bit of the backstory. I'm not sure it exactly happened like that, right? But I do know this. I am sure of this. Saul was handpicked by God. His name was changed to Paul, and he set out for the next 20 or so years traveling the entire world, that side of the world, to change the world for Jesus. That's his name. And he also wrote over half the New Testament that we read from in this place every single week. He wrote half, including the book we're reading from today, 2 Corinthians, which is his second letter to a church in Corinth. Now, why does he write a letter to a church in Corinth? Here's the reason why. Because he hears they're hopeless. He hears that they, like a lot of us, they are absolutely hopeless. They are struggling with all the problems and the challenges and the issues that they're facing in their lives. And they just feel so hopeless. He hears that. And they're losing heart and they're losing hope and they're ready to give up on God altogether. And Paul's like, whoa, 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 whoa. So he writes this letter to them. You want to know what the context of the letter is? Here's the theme of this book. Hey, don't give up. Don't give up, don't give up, don't give up. There's hope, there's hope, there's hope, there's hope. And he uses, you know what he uses? He uses his own story, his own experience, his own life to illustrate that. That's what he's doing here. And he says, there was a moment when this really hard thing hit my life and I asked God to take it away. In other words, Paul looked up one day and there was a gap between the reality of his life and what he really wanted his life to be. There was a gap. Can we relate to that? Of course we can. We need to talk about that gap, because what's true of Paul is true of us too, and it goes like this: hopelessness. This hopelessness that we feel inside grows. It grows. It festers. This is fertile ground in the gap between what we need and what God does or is doing in our lives. Hopelessness grows in that gap. It's true, isn't it? Just think about it. When there is no gap between what you need, and I got to add this part, what you think you need in your life, when there is no gap between what you need or think you need and what God is doing in your life or what's actually happening in your life, you've got hope, right? Hopelessness grows in the gap. It grows in this gap, and it's true. We're not alone in this. Man, there's story after story after story through the Bible. We looked at one last week, right? John the Baptist. Is there a gap between his reality and what he wants his life to be? Yes. He's sitting in prison. He doesn't want to sit in prison. He loses hope with every day that passes that he sits in prison. Lazarus' sisters send word to Jesus. He's sick and dying. Jesus says, we're going to stay here. We're not going there. They lose hope as what? They're in the gap between what they want their brother's life to look like and what it currently is. And now we're dealing with another person of faith, another devout follower of Jesus, totally sold out, who's living out less than desirable circumstances in his life. For him, it's a thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment him. Now we got to talk about, what does that mean? What does that mean? Well, what it doesn't mean is like a little thorn off a thorn bush, the ouch moment. You pull it out of the tweezers, wrap it up in a Band-Aid, and you're good to go. Let's really talk about what Paul's describing here. First thing he says is this. He says, it was given to me. Now, that's an odd statement, isn't it? It was given to me. If you unpack the Greek here, the Greek word translated given here is like a Christmas gift. That's odd. It's a positive thing. It's a good thing. It's something that we want. So this thorn is a good gift. Now, if you're having trouble believing that, accepting that, understanding that, I get it. Just hang on to that, okay? Hopefully we will by the time we get to the end of the day. So this was given to him. That's odd. Hang on to that. Second thing is this. Let's talk about this thorn. The Greek word here translated thorn is like a sharpened wooden stake used for torturing or impaling someone. So, all that to say, this is not just a flat tire on the way to church kind of thing. This thorn is a big deal. It's a very big deal. And you know what? We're never told what it is. Now, scholars like to argue about those kind of things, and they say it was malaria, some say epilepsy, some say he had an eye condition. It doesn't really matter what it is. Whatever it is, here's what matters. Whatever it was so painful, so debilitating, so humiliating, so hard on Paul that he relentlessly asked God to intervene, fix it, heal it, or take it away. That was his approach. God, here's the deal. I need you to do something in my life. Come, intervene, heal this, fix this, or take it away. That's the reality of this moment for Saul, for Paul. And guess what? That's why it's important. Because every single one of us, right here as we sit here today, we can relate to have something like that in our lives too. What is that in your life as you sit here today? What is that in your life? You say, and what are you doing with it? Well, here's what we typically do. I talked about this a little bit last week in my own struggle. But here's what we typically do, and this is inside and outside the church. There's really no real difference. We turn to people. These kind of things hit our lives, we turn to people. Our counselors, our friends, our pastor, our priest, whatever it might be for you, we turn to people. We turn to pills. Some of us turn to pills. We turn to programs. We turn to programs. And some of us eventually get to the point where we turn to prayer. Now I like what my friend Jim up at Flatiron says, Flatiron's Church. I was just with him this past week. I've heard him say this before. He says, when these kind of things hit your life, I believe in three things: people, pills, and prayer. Not necessarily in that order, but he believes in three things. I will add prayers prescribed to you, for you, by your doctor, okay? Let's just keep it real. But here's what we see in this moment. Paul gets really spiritual here, and he goes straight to prayer. He goes straight to prayer, and he asks God, he says, will you please take this away? Please take this away. And if you interpret this, it's not just three prayers over 20-plus years. This is three seasons of prayer. This is three periods of time where he prayed just regularly. Okay, so like 6 months, a year, two-year periods, 2 years blocks. I'm praying every single day, 20 times a day. Take this away, take this away, take this away, take this away. We can all relate to that too, can't we? I mean, a lot of us have been praying for God to change something in our lives for a long, long time. And what it suggests here is the very first two seasons that Paul prayed it, nothing happened. That God either said no or God was completely silent. And a lot of us can relate to that too. And when that happens in our life, what happens? We lose hope. We lose hope. God, I really need you to intervene. I need you to take this away. And we lose hope. I don't have to try to convince you that this is true. We all know this is true. Hopelessness grows in the gap that exists between what we want our lives to be and what God is currently doing in our lives. So what do we do with that gap? Is there anything we can do to close that gap or to help with that gap? Well, let's keep reading here. Verse 9. But he, God, said to me, said back to Paul, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, he says, Paul says, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses so that Christ's power may rest on me. All right? So Paul finally gets an answer. Third season, it's like, yes, finally God's going to speak. I'm so ready to hear this, God. What you going to do? And the answer is, my grace is sufficient for you. My grace is sufficient for you. In other words, Paul, I'm not going to change this. Paul, I'm not going to take this away. I'm not going to make this going away. But here's what you need to know. My grace is sufficient for you. See, I don't know about you, but that's not a very satisfying answer for me, is it? I mean, where do you find hope in that? How do you find hope in that? We struggle to find hope in that. You know why? Here's why. Because we find hope in performance, not promises. This is what we find our hope in performance, not promises. I've been married 31 years now, and I'm going to tell you something. I have a lot of hope for my marriage. In fact, I have more hope for my marriage today than I ever have. In 31 years. That hope is not in all the promises that Stacy's made to me over 31 years. And the hope she finds in our marriage is not in all the promises I've made over 31 years. It's what? It's in how we've performed, how we've treated each other, how we've interact with each other. See, here's the thing. I don't think it really matters how devoutly religious Paul is here, how spiritual he is. I think he's disappointed with this response. I can't prove it, but I got to think initially he was disturbed by this response because it wasn't the response he was looking for. What was he looking for? God, I want you to take this thing totally and completely away from me. And instead of that, he gets what? He gets a promise. He's asking for actions. God, do something. I'm asking for actions and I get words. I'm asking for actions, I get words. It's frustrating. And you know what? If I'm going to get words, could you at least give me an explanation instead of a promise? It's frustrating, isn't it? I'm telling you, we all have these things in our lives, points of pain, whatever it is. It just won't go away, and we're wrestling with this. And come on, we're praying the prayers, and it's not changing. And because of that, this is the very thing that causes a lot of us to struggle with even believing in God altogether. Because how could a loving God, compassionate, caring God, who cares so much about his people, allow his people to go through stuff like that? So some of us, it's like, this is why I can't believe. For those of us that do, though, we believe, but we do exactly what Paul's doing here. We reach out to God, and we say, God, I'm dying here. Take it away, take it away, take it away. We don't just pray it once or twice or three times. We pray it over a season of time in our life, And it doesn't go away, and we find ourselves starting to get frustrated, a little angry with God. Maybe we shake our fist. We tell him if we were God, we'd do a much better job than he's doing. We give him some good godly advice. What is going on inside of us? What are we really looking for? The answer is so simple. We're looking for performance. God, I just need you to do what it is that I'm asking you to do. It's how we pray. It's how we pray. Just think about it. Your girlfriend calls you. She says, I'm late. And you know she's not talking about dinner. What do you do in that moment? Let me tell you what you do. It doesn't matter if you haven't been in church in 20 years. It doesn't matter if you haven't prayed in 15 years. I haven't even thought about God in 15 years. All of a sudden, it's like, oh, no. Oh, God. Right? Help me. Help me. I need you right now, God. And you start making all kinds of promises, right? God, I need you to do something here. And so I promise you, get the Bible out, blow the dust off. You know, it's like, whoa, Genesis 1, God, I'm going to read through my Bible in a year. I promise you this. If you would just what? Here's what you're not looking for in that moment. Listen. Hey, I promise you, I'm going to see you through the pregnancy. You're going to marry her. It's going to be okay. That's not what you're looking for. What are you looking for in that moment? You're looking for performance, not a promise. You look up one night and there's a cop behind you. Police officer on your tail. Which wouldn't really be a problem, except happy hour became happy hours for you. Right? You spend hours at the bar. You know you shouldn't be driving. In that moment, what do? Oh, no. Oh, God. Right? Please, I don't want him to crash into another car, but please make him veer off the road. Make this police officer go away. Right? Make the cop car disappear. I need a miracle here, God. What are you looking for? You're not looking for God to say to you, hey, you know what? I'm going to see you through this DUI process, through the conviction. You're going to spend a couple nights in jail, but it's going to be okay. Now, you need God. You want God to perform here. You get a call from your friend. He says, you know what? I saw your wife today at lunchtime. I didn't really want to call you, but I felt like as a friend I had to. And she's having lunch with this really good-looking young guy. And it wasn't like they weren't close. You could tell they really are connected. And all of a sudden, boom, your heart just sinks in your chest. Come on, we all have those moments, right? We all have those kind of moments. And in that moment, it's like, God, there is absolutely nothing I can do. There's nothing I can do. I'm absolutely powerless here, and so I really need you to do something. Please do something for me. And sometimes what happens? He does something. Your girlfriend, she calls you back. She says, whoop, false alarm. I had the flu. Wow. And the police officer, he pulls you over, and he walks up to the car, and he looks in the window. He says, sir, you have a taillight out. Get it fixed. Merry Christmas. And this stuff never happens to me, by the way, but just play along. All right. Or your wife comes home from work, she says, you'll never believe who I ran into today and ended up having lunch with, my gay cousin John. And all of a sudden you're like, I love John. I've always loved John. John's my fave, man. He's just, oh, John, you're awesome. What happens? All of a sudden hope just comes, boom, crashing down. It's like the clouds have lifted and there's hope again and you are happy. You've been set free. You are no longer what? Dependent on God at all. And so you drop to your knees, and what do? You say, God, I promise you I'm going to go be a missionary. No, nobody does that, right? That's not real. You don't do that. What do? You forget and you move on with your life. Why? Why? Because we find hope in performance, not in promises. And God knows that. He created us. And he knows that with Paul, too. And so he says to Paul, he says, I know what you're asking for, and listen, I know you say you trust me. In fact, you're going to write that down, and millions of people are going to read it over thousands of years. I know you say you trust me, but here's what I really need you to do. I want and I need you to live your life every single day totally and completely dependent on me. If I don't, Paul, you can't. Right? Without my help, you are done. Paul, that's what I want you to do. So, I'm not going to take it away. I got a better idea. I'm going to see you through it. I'm not going to take it away, Paul. I'm going to see you through it. See, we think one way. We think remove it. And God thinks, how about I use it? How about I use it? You know, I think about my own journey with God, which has been up and down, you know. Here's one thing that I've come to realize about me. The things I most often ask God to take out of my life are the very things that cause me to have to depend on him the most. You see that correlation in your life? The things that I ask God on a regular basis to remove from my life are the very things that cause me to depend on him the most. When I came here 7.5 years ago, I was coming out of the desert. I'd crashed and burned in ministry, had an affair. It was terrible. Been on faith, resigned from ministry, went into counseling. My wife, Stacy, stayed with me. It was the only beautiful part of that desert experience for me. Really, really hard time. So I thought, coming out of that, several years of that, that I had learned all I needed to learn in the desert. And I couldn't have been more wrong. So I get here, and I've told this story many times because it's just a very important moment in my life. Beginning of 2010, and church isn't growing. We're broke. Rent's coming due. We can't afford it. It looked like we were going to have to close the doors of this church. We were probably about 100 people at the time. And I was just a mess. I was an absolute mess. See, here's what I did. I made the mistake of thinking when I came here, I thought, man, if I just pour all I've got into this church, if I just throw all my talent, all my energy, all my effort, if I work 70, 80, 90 hours a week, whatever that takes, if I preach the best I know how and lead the best I know how, if I just perform and I ask God to do his part, he'll perform, he'll bless it, it's going to be good. But that didn't happen. And I was absolutely and completely hopeless. And what I didn't understand then that I've come to understand now is that God was trying to teach me something in the pain, in the uncertainty, in the pressure, in the issues and the challenges that I didn't see. And what he was trying to teach me was this: Greg, I really want and I really need every single day of your life for you to be totally and completely dependent on me. If I don't, Greg, you can't. Without me, you're done. And I look back on that time in my life, and my prayer was this: God, remove it, take it away, take it away, take it away, take it away, get it out of here, all the problems, the issues, the challenges, make this easier, God. And he says, nope, I'm not going to take it away. How about this? How about I just use it? Use it. I'm not going to change your circumstances. My focus is not necessarily on changing the circumstances. Here's my focus. It's on changing you. And so what I've learned, and I continue to learn on this journey with God, is this. I continue to learn that I've got to learn to find hope, not just in the performance of God, but in his promises too. I think there's something there for all of us. Well, let's finish this up, okay? So verse 10, one more verse. That is why, Paul says, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses and insults and hardships and persecutions and difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. All right, so Paul says, I delight in the very things that used to leave me hopeless. I now find delight in those things. I find joy in those things. And I'm like, time out, Paul. Come here, man. I got to talk to you. That's a misprint, right? You meant to say despair. You despair in hardship and persecution and illnesses and all this stuff, right? You despair. No, I meant to say delight. I delight. No. You meant to say despair. No, it's delight. Well, how do you delight? How do you find hope in stuff like this? That's the question that we all have, isn't it? And here it is. Here's what Paul's pointing us to here. Hope. Hope comes, you're sitting here and you're hopeless today, hope comes when we shift from the problem, when we shift our focus from the problem to the promise and the purpose. It's not easy to do. It's not easy to do. See, a problem hits our life and it tends to be our focus, doesn't it? I'm not telling you it shouldn't be. And we focus on the problem, what do? We turn to people, we turn to pills, we turn to programs, we turn to prayer. When we do pray, we expect performance. I'm not saying those aren't good things. What I'm saying is this: Paul's pointing us to something different. Two other words that happen to start with P: promise and purpose. Promise and purpose. Even in these hopeless moments in our lives, rather than focusing solely on the problem, we need to start to try to train ourselves and teach ourselves to hang on to the promises of God until the purpose is revealed. And that's the hardest part, because here's the reality for us. One of the biggest challenges we face is the purpose is most often not obvious. You can't see it in the moment. There seems to be no purpose to the pain that you're experiencing in your life. It makes absolutely no sense. But I want you to think about it. It's not only difficult when we can't see the purpose and it's not clear to us, even when we know the purpose of the pain, it's still not easy. You know how I know that? Jesus, think about it. The night he's arrested, before he's arrested to be led off and brutally beaten and then crucified on a cross, before he's arrested, he's in the garden. What's he doing? He's praying. It says his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. Okay, I've never prayed that intensely. He's praying that intense. Here's the thing. Jesus knows the purpose. He knows the purpose. He knew the purpose when he came. When he was born, that baby in a manger, that thing we're going to celebrate in a few weeks, he knew the purpose. He just didn't like the path. He didn't want to travel the path. So he, like Paul, and like a lot of us, says, Father, take this cup away from me. Can we change or alter the path? And here's what we got to see. Even when God said no or said nothing at all, you know what Jesus did? He leaned into the only thing that he could lean into in that moment. His Father's promise and the purpose. His Father's purpose. And he said, not my will, not what I want, but your will, what you want, be done. Right? When there are no solutions, are there still options for us? Yes. Are they easy? No way. No way. You know, I have a beautiful wife. Her name is Stacy. I've married way over my head. Most guys have. Most of you have too, so you can go ahead and say me too. Right? Jason's sitting down here. He did. Trust me. My wife's beautiful. And she's not one to want to be in the spotlight, right, to be the center of attention or the life of the party. That's not her. She's very quiet and very reserved. And you won't see her up on stage. You'll see her out in the cafe, or you'll see her out there wiping tables or serving coffee, just kind of behind the scenes doing her thing. That's what she prefers to do. And she's so beautiful on the outside. That's the obvious part. But beneath that is this inner beauty that unfortunately very few people get to experience and very few people get to see. My wife has a beautiful heart. She has a beautiful heart. And over the course of 31 years of marriage, I have single-handedly, more than once, just absolutely crushed her heart. I remember over a decade ago, one night, where I watched her sit out on our deck at our house in North Carolina. From about 10 p.m. till about 7 a.m. the next morning, all by herself, crying her eyes out, trying her best to survive the knife that my unfaithfulness had just driven through her heart. My girl has known hopeless. My girl has known hopeless. She has. And I hate it. I'm so sorry for that. She was in first service sitting down here today, and it's the first time I said to her, I'm so sorry. It's the first time I've ever apologized to her publicly, I think. And I got two of my daughters saying, I'm so sorry for what I've done to your mom. My girl has known hopeless. And yet, you know what I get to do? I get to sit next to her at least one service every single week, and I get to watch her become totally undone and unglued and cry at every single story from every single baptism video like Derek's today. And in that moment, it's the most beautiful moment of all for me, because I feel like God is saying to her, way to go, Stacy. Way to go. You held on to my promise. Right? There was hope. It wasn't hopeless. I promise you, it wasn't hopeless. But in the moment, as she's going through that, She didn't feel that. She couldn't see that. In fact, that path that she had to travel involved a lot more pain before she would ever be able to see it. And she held onto this promise. All things work together for good. Stacy, I need you to trust me. I've got you. My grace is sufficient for you. And I will see you through this. And I get to stand up here and be a part of this incredible story today because somehow, some way, my girl was able to take her focus off of the problem and focus on the promise and the purpose of God. And I think what she'd say to you as you sit here today is this: look, even if your life seems impossible, it's not. There is hope for you. I think, let's be honest, this is the hardest part of this whole Christianity, Jesus following thing, isn't it? It really is. This is the hardest part, and I'm not claiming to be an expert. Honestly, I fail at this as much as I succeed. But God says here, my power, my strength is available to you, and it will see. I will see you through. And Paul says, when I was weak, I was strong. He says, I became stronger and better and more the man I wanted to be as what? As God continued to refuse to take this thing out of my life. Really what he's saying into this, it was a gift with a promise and a purpose. And it is so hard for us, isn't it? It's so hard for us to believe that's true. I think one of the most unfortunate things for us is this. We see this clearly in weightlifting, but we don't see it in our own lives and stories. And what I'm getting to is this. We make the greatest gains when we get to the end of our own strength. We do. We make the greatest gains when we get to the end of our own strength. We're on the bench, the barbell's on our chest, and we can't budge it. We've tried. And so what do? We cry out, come over here, get this weight off of me. And so here comes God. God comes over and he takes a look and he says, no, you know what? I'm not going to take it away. Right? Why? Because you'll be better off if I just help you lift it. This last rep is what makes you stronger. And next time, it's not going to feel near as heavy to you. You're going to be amazed at how strong you will be. My power is made perfect in your weakness. My power is made perfect in your weakness. Listen, I just want to say to you today, God's silence or his inaction in your life right now is not an indication that he doesn't care about you. Nothing could be further from the truth. It is an opportunity for him to showcase his strength in your weakness. And I understand if you can't accept that. If you're just not ready for that yet, I get it. I really do, but this is what I want to say to you. Let's be honest. The other things that we're turning to in life are not working either. So what if this is the way forward for us? When I face the impossible, when I feel absolutely and completely hopeless because I am, when there's nothing I can do, even when the circumstances of my life are not changing, I am going to hold on to God's promises to see me through to the best that I can until his purpose is revealed. With confidence that he's doing something here, that he is changing me. Even when I can't see it, I'm going to hold on to the promise until his purpose is revealed in me or in this. Even when there are no solutions, there's still options. Even when there's no real solution, I promise you, there is still hope. There is still hope. We are not finished. We're going to pick it up there. There is so much for us to talk about next week. So we hope you come back. Let's pray. Jesus, we need you. We need you. Thank you for example after example after example of people in the Bible, and life just did not go the way that they wanted it to. Less than desirable circumstances. There's a huge gap between the reality of their lives and what they want their life to be. And they need you to do something. Jesus, we ask you to come into that space with us. We need you. Help us to trust when you choose to not do the things that we're asking you to do. Jesus, help us to focus on these and begin to learn to find hope, not just in your performance when you do what it is we ask you to do, but in these promises that all things work together for good, that your grace is sufficient for us, your power is made perfect in our weakness, that you won't allow anything to come on us that we can't handle, that you're right there with us and you will see us through. When we tend to think that the only option, Jesus, is take it away, help us to see that you may have a purpose beyond that. That will not be clear to us in the moment. But just hang on. Help us to hang on to that promise until your purpose in that is revealed. Jesus, I thank you for what you've done in my life and story. There's so much hope in you. Regardless of where we sit today, there's so much hope in you. Help us to believe that as we walk out of this room today, Jesus. That's our prayer. In your name, amen.
Hey DCC, thanks for being here today. If this is your first time here, we're glad that you're here. Make sure you get a free donut out at the cafe before you leave and fill out the What's Up card in the seat in front of you to let us know that you were here today. I'm Kyle, and these are your announcements this week. Christmas Eve is a little over 2 weeks away, and this year we're having two candlelight services at 3 p.m. and 5 p.m. Child care will be provided for younger children, but any kids kindergarten up will need to come to service. Christmas Eve is also a great time to invite people to church, so grab an invite card as you leave the auditorium today. We also have a Facebook event, so you can invite people through social media. We have a great service planned, so we hope you, your family, and your friends will join us on Christmas Eve. We are also going to need a bunch of volunteers for Christmas Eve, so if you're willing to serve at one service and attend another, it will help us out in a huge way. There's all sorts of ways that you can help, so just head over to the serve table by the garage to find out more and get signed up. After Christmas Eve is over, we will be taking a week off. That means there will not be church on December 27th. I repeat, there will be no church on December 27th. That's the Sunday after Christmas. We recommend sleeping in, spending time with family, maybe watching some football, and eating way too much food. But whatever you do, just don't show up here. The building will be locked, no one will be here, and you'll probably feel a little silly. However, we will be having a work day on Saturday, January 2nd to get the building ready for our first service of the new year. If you want to help, head over to the serve table and get signed up. We started Cole last week and your response was unbelievable. If you don't know what I'm talking about, every year we buy Christmas gifts for people who otherwise might not get any gifts. We call it Cole, Christmas on another level. This year we're buying gifts for 250 foster kids at Hope and Home, as well as 17 families that could use some hope this Christmas. Last week you took most of the tags that we had in the lobby, which is absolutely amazing. Thank you so much for your heart of generosity, DCC. If you missed it last week and want to be a part of Cole, there are still a few tags left. Just go out to the lobby and take as many tags as you want, buy the gifts on the tag, wrap them, and bring them back by the date specified on the tag. Every year, your generosity just blows these people away, and it's so much fun to be a part of. So let's clear out those tags and show people the love of Jesus with no strings attached. That's all the announcements this week. If you want to stay connected with everything that's going on at DCC, download our app, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. We hope you have a great week, and we hope to see you again next week.
Okay, so there are no tags left. Yeah, isn't that amazing? First service took all the tags that were left on the wall, so they're all gone. That's great. The bad part is none of them signed up to serve on Christmas Eve because I forgot to tell them, all right? And apparently, even though Kyle or whoever says that, we don't, that was Kyle, but who's our normal guy? Grant, that's his name. Until you get 50, everything, two goes. Grant, even though they say it, we don't hear it sometimes. We need your help, okay? So the serve table's out by the garage. If you could go there and you could help us either on Christmas Eve or to come in on Saturday for a few hours, January 2nd, and help us clean the building and get ready for services on January 3rd, that would be great. Both would be awesome, but you go out, look left, serve table's over by the garage. Hey, if you want to get connected here, want to know about next steps at DCC, go out, go to that same room, the garage over there, great people there that can help you. There'll be people to pray with you and talk with you under both these screens to my right and my left right after the service, so come up here right after the walkout song. If you want to sign up for something, go out the doors, look to the middle. The info booth is right there where you can take care of that. And the last thing is this, if you believe in what God's doing here and you want to be a part of it financially, we need more and more of you to partner with us. There's no pressure. If you're new, this is not for you, but there are boxes on the wall there, and you can hit our app or you can hit our website if you choose to give that way. Hey, thanks for being here today. I'm up again next week for week three of this series. Hope we'll see you back. I'll be out by the fireplace if you want to talk to me. Go Broncos, right? All right, we'll see you next week.